particle like motion along the z-axis. So what will happen is that these sharp lines will get little fuzzy if you also bring in the kz quantum number. Plus, when you bring in the fermionic effects, which I have ignored here because it's still non-degenerate electron case, the steps will not look that sharp anymore, but they'll nevertheless stay as steps. So they say the susceptibility oscillates. Susceptibility oscillates between these values, and these are called the Haas-Van-Alphen-Shubnikov oscillations. Associated with diamagnetism. This is all dia because magnetism occurs from the orbital motion of the electron, and that is why magnetization always has a negative sign in front, unlike the Pauli paramagnetism. My time there were multiple copies. And the reason I gave this reference, now I'm going to do quantum Hall effect, integer quantum Hall effect to begin with. And I have used for my notes Joe Imrie's book. It's called Introduction to Mesoscopic Physics. So let's go back to the basic issue of resistance, right? And we actually had a little discussion on this at one of the earlier lectures, that what do you do when you have a battery on a resistor? You measure current, and so you write down the elementary, classical, so far no quantum mechanics yet. It's called the Drude theory. This part you can also read from Ashcroft and Mervyn, the first chapter itself. Solid state physics. What is it called? Solid state physics. Introduction to solid state physics. So, what is the Drude business? That if I have a metallic wire, then the electrons, of course, would be going in random directions. To channelize electrons, you put a battery, right? This is high school stuff. So, what do you write? You say that m times v dot, mass times the acceleration, must be equal to the force. The force is E times electric intensity. So, E. If you put minus the magnitude, if you put the magnitude of E, then you'll have a minus sign. So if it's an electron, then the E is negative. And I can have an ion also, no problem, the same equation. But we are looking at electrons. And we have a Lorentz force also, right? This is because of the magnetic field. So now Dr. Khatua's point, that you have a combination of an electric field and a magnetic field situation. So this is the Lorentz force and this is Coulomb. This is Lorentz. And that's Coulomb. But that's not quite it, because we said that the fact that there is a resistance of a wire is because the electrons cannot move coherently. They get scattered, suffered collisions, either due to defects, due to other electrons, due to phonons, and so you put a Drude dissipative term, and this is something that we already introduced earlier, and this is what is called, this is given various names. What is the most commonly accepted name? It's called a scattering time, or mean free time, or
relaxation time.
Good, I like that. pundits will tell you that today there's a lot of interest in what are called correlated electron systems, where electrons interact so strongly that you have exotic behavior, not understandable normally. But the Drude equation is still robust. It is only in that calculation of this relaxation time all the complications come in. But the basic constitutive equation still remains the same. So this is your basic equation to start with if you do what you said about Hall bar experiments, etc. And it is, since everything is happening along in the xy plane, it is it's convenient to write things in terms of the x and y. So as the most convenient way of writing, remember yesterday we solved such equations in the absence of the electric field, did not have a tau, but we introduced V, you know, because you have Vx and Vy coupled, and we introduce a V plus and V minus. V plus was Vx plus IVy, V minus. So we do the same thing, except that we don't put Vx plus IVy. You can write it in terms of a column and write things in terms of a 2x2 matrix. Whenever you have coupled differential equations, you can have matrix representation, right? So you get M, Vx dot, Vy dot is the left hand side, right? Because I have two components, MVx dot, MVy dot. First term is very simple. I simply have Ex, Ey. As Dr. Katwa said, that you can apply electric field, choose to apply electric field as a vector along both x and y. Magnetic field continues to be only one vector along the z-axis. You have M by tau. Again, this is Vx, Vy now. This is this term, right? This term is a little screwy because the x component will couple to the y component of the velocity. So here you have minus Eb by C, Vy minus Vx. Be careful, right? It's not a mistake. But here in the first entry, it's the y component that comes in. That's why the two equations are coupled. And you know it very well that you can actually then write everything in terms of, just one second. So now we are going to consider the steady state problem. It is the steady state in which you write Ohm's law. There's nothing is time dependent. So in the steady state, like Pradeep will tell you, that we switch the electric field and the magnetic field on, things have transient effects, but there's a lot of junk in the material, the junk goes into relaxation time, so the system will eventually stabilize, you get into a steady state, and in the steady state, this terminal will go to zero. So you may ask the question to Dr. Khatua, Patu, etc., that are you sure that you have reached a steady state? Sometimes experimentally it's not very easy, because the relaxation times get long, then transient effects do not die out so easily. But if you have waited long enough compared to this tau, then you say that I have reached a steady state. I must say that it's not always that you look only at the steady state. The transient effects, non-equilibrium stuff is also important if you get trapped into metastable valleys, etc., for a glassy system. But that's a different ballgame altogether. But in the steady state, you have this equal to zero. And so now, and furthermore, you remember that when you did Ohm's law, you also write the current density as NEV. Right? N is the number density, E is the charge. This is something, again, we have discussed before. So you can put everything in terms of a matrix. You get matrix, 2x2 matrix, 1, Eb tau divided by Mc, Eb tau over Mc, 1, Jx, Jy is equal to the quantity sigma 0, Ex, Ey. What is sigma 0? Sigma 0 is defined as Ne. Let me just read it out. So So I get, somebody can help me, people can help me. So each, this Vx, okay, this is this term, right? And so I want to have, because I've got submerged in the xeroscopy. So Jx is any V.
Do this exercise.
J is equal to sigma e. So this is J equal to sigma e, but what is this sigma naught I'm trying to figure out from this?
Should be n squared now by n.
Exactly, okay. Yes, indeed, that is the true day. Correct. Thanks, boy. So, as people said, that this is your Ohm's law. It says, Ohm's law says sigma is going to be a tensor. So I can put in sigma naught here. And why should sigma naught go there? Yeah, J equal to sigma, sure. No, sorry, I don't do that. That comes in the second result. So from this I get Jx, J1 as constant sigma naught and this matrix inverse times Ex, Ey. What is this inverse of this 2 by 2 matrix? Everybody has done this, right? So you simply have the diagonal elements remain the same here because it's 1 and 1, otherwise they would be interchanged, right? And the off-diagonal element simply, let me just see, is it correct? Minus? Is it correct? We can easily verify. And you get a determinant also, of course. And the determinant is 1 minus d squared, tau squared over n squared. Let me write it clearly.
So both the off diagonal terms will be negative.
Why? No, so determinant is a plus sign. So I have written obviously something wrong here.
Both the off-diagonal terms will be negative.
Any Vx should be this term. Any Vx plus this times Jy, which should come from this term, dvt over x, so that's a positive term. So that's the negative term. So here's the negative side. No, sorry. So this is still... So the whole thing has come to this side, so everything is positive. So so I have any Vx, the Vx term comes from this term, plus B times this Vy term, so that's that term, so both are positive. But the next one is Vy, so that's EBT, and then I get a positive term, so this is a negative sign here. That's why there's a positive sign in the determinant here, okay? And so this is correct, actually, what I wrote. So, yeah. So this is of the Ohm's law form. J is equal to sigma matrix, right? Sigma is now a matrix because here I have sigma xx, sigma xy, sigma yx, and sigma yy. And so this is Ohm's law. And this is now the conductivity matrix. Associated with the conductivity matrix, you have a resistivity. So the resistivity rho is also in our matrix. And resistivity rho is sigma naught inverse. And this is B over NEC. This is minus B over NEC. Again, you invert it. And so resistivity matrix is the inverse of the conductivity matrix. Resistivity that you can easily check by taking the sigma naught to this side. So it's a sigma naught inverse, and this is simply EBT tau over MC when you put in the value of everything at the scale of tau. And so now the conductivity sigma is something that I wrote down, write down here. The conductivity tensor is here already. I've introduced. So minus B over, and you see maybe this is then minus and this is plus. Please check when you invert this. Basically, if what the formula I use, that if I have an arbitrary 2D 2x2 matrix, the inverse of this is the determinant, which is AD minus BC. And then, as the lady there said, you interchange the diagonal elements and you simply. What do you do? You just interchange B and. No.
Interchange
A and B. And then both the off diagonal terms acquire negative sign.
Minus B minus C.
Minus B minus C, right? Because then you can check. If I multiply again A, B, C, D by B minus C, A, I must get a unit matrix with the determinant. So I get A, D minus B, C, which is the determinant. And this minus AB plus BA plus AB is 0. AD, and this is AD minus CD is 0 again. And this is AD minus BC again. Correct. So that's what you get. So both have negative sign. So that's the most general 2x2. You have to get 0 here.
No, I'm not talking about that steady state.
In the steady state.
So you have always 1 minus negative. Because of
this. So we both are negative,
no? No.
One is
actually, in the force equation, why have you taken minus C by over C D plus B? And electric field is plus.
This is where maybe I have goofed up the sign somewhere. He is right that I've been inconsistent. I have taken, so I think, I guess this we put in there and then everything. We'll just check, you know, in old. As I said, this breakfast. But it's got an excellent breakfast, I must say. Much better than the guest house. Guest house only gave andas.
Cheese sandwich.
Cheese, and he made hummus.
Hummus.
You know what is hummus? Activity factors. And because of that, so my lack of ability to do algebra can be attributed to my eating hummus in the morning. And so you have sigma xx. Now these things hopefully are right, my last expressions. So it's sigma naught. This is still static. There is no frequency dependence. D sigma naught, NEC squared. And then you have sigma xy is equal to minus sigma yx, and that's equal to minus sigma naught omega naught tau over 1 plus omega naught tau squared. Now let me now draw you, let me now draw you the experimental setup that Pradeep mentioned. So that's something very illustrative. So that's how you make measurements. It becomes extremely important. What component of resistivity are you measuring for mesoscopic nanosystem sample, which is like heat? And I just draw this and then continue tomorrow. And you have a source of electron. You put in electrons here, and there's a sink here. They are called leads sometimes. Is that lead? I've learned all these things. Okay. Israelis are so good at this. Right? And hummus. So this is a hall bar. So you have a current going like this. And so this name has already been mentioned by Kudip. Hall bar. So basically, it's a system for magnetoresistance, resistance, all effect measurement.